Thank you very much for having me here today. I have to say, when my colleagues and I started thinking about writing this paper, we really didn't know if anybody would read it. It's not like the hierarchy of laws is a really exciting topic, but we've really had a lot of interest in this discussion and how laws fit together, how where the law comes from, who changes the law, and the hierarchy of law. And so I have to thank my co-authors, Michael Clegg, Katie Elena, and David Ennis, who used to work in Ukraine for a long time, who helped draft this publication. So I think, I don't know how many of you are lawyers, but I think for non-lawyers, many times the law is a very confusing thing. And I think many times people think of the law and they think of this chart over here on the right, that it really doesn't make sense, that there's no structure, there's conflict. It's not really sure how things fit together. But in reality, it's more like the figure on the left. There really is a structure to the law when it's done properly. And you can figure out how they fit together, which one is superior to the next, and how you can actually write legislation, who has authority, etc. So I hope after this discussion we'll think more about the law as it's represented up here on the left. I think, you know, all countries, and I've worked around the world for 20 years, and all countries, you know, have a legal foundation in which they operate. And all of these laws function in a hierarchy. And there's a structure to them, and they determine how each law works with the other and who has authority over subject matters and individuals. And of course, the supreme law of the land usually resides in the Constitution, which sets the country's characteristics and establishes its sovereignty. It establishes the rights and responsibilities of individuals and citizens. And most importantly, in a democracy, the Constitution derives its authority from the people, that it is the people that give the Constitution its authority. And therefore, it is the supreme law of the land, and all of the other laws underneath the Constitution must reside within the authority of the Constitution. Statutes and legislation, as you all know, are the formal rules that govern behavior, transactions, and social policies. They maintain social order and add security and govern economic relationships and processes. And the authority for whoever can write the legislation and its scope of authority, of course, has to be drawn from the Constitution. And so it's the first part removed from the Constitution. Over on the right-hand side, there's things like treaties, international obligations, common law, etc. I'll talk about those a little bit later. I think for now I'll turn to regulations. And I think this last part of this chart is where there can be a lot of confusion. Regulations are basically delegated legislation. That in fact, the regulations are usually written by an administrative body. So in my experience, working on elections, it's the election commission who usually writes regulations. And then underneath that are procedures. And procedures are really very specific. They're very specific steps to complete a process. And I've noticed in Ukraine, and this isn't unique to Ukraine, sometimes there are procedures and regulations. And I think that can complicate things. And one thing that you have to be very sure of, and something that my colleague Michael Clegg, who's worked in this field for a lot longer than I have, you really need to think about this hierarchy in regards to how easy it is to change the law. The Constitution should be very difficult to change. They should be fundamental rights. There must be a majority of the people, usually through a referenda or some other supermajority that would change the Constitution. The legislation has to be changed by the parliament or the legislature. Regulations and procedures can be changed by the administrative body. Procedures should be very specific. So if the administrative body realizes that a procedure isn't working, they should be able to fix it. And it should be rather simple. Whereas you don't want that in the legislation, because a procedure that's put in the legislation, you might find out in practice it is not working, and then you have to change the entire law to change that procedure. So we really do want to make it easier down on the bottom part of this chart for administrative bodies to change the procedures. However, any procedure or regulation or statute must, of course, be consistent with the Constitution. For example, if voter ID is something that the court has, I mean the EMB has decided, the election management body, sorry, has decided is required to prove residency, but the residency requirements aren't consistent with the Constitution, then that regulation or that procedure could be found to be unconstitutional and vacated. So I think you always have to be thinking any of these steps along the way if it fits within the Constitution. So why does this matter? Why does this matter to our work? And like I said, I mostly work with election management bodies on elections. One thing is that within the structure of the law, you can obviously convey international standards. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights gives people the right to vote in secret, gives them the right to run for office. That's usually enshrined in the Constitution. It reinforces the rule of law. If for some reason a procedure or a way in which an individual is interpreting a law, if they're found to be contrary to the Constitution, they should be reprimanded or the law should be vacated. It's the law that matters, not the individuals within this framework. And the hierarchy of law brings that point home. It also, and this is something that is extremely important, is that clearly written and drafted laws determine the rules of the game. And so everybody who's involved in an election, for example, or in any civil litigation, they know the rules of the game. They know what's required of them. If the laws are clear and well written, they know what they have to do to register as a candidate. They know the political finance rules. They know how they must disclose. They know how they can challenge a complaint if it's filed. And all of this must be clearly defined within the legal framework. And if the hierarchy of laws isn't adhered to, this becomes confused. And I think it makes it difficult on candidates and parties to operate within an environment without a clear hierarchy of laws. It also, and this is something in my experience, that many election management bodies have a bit of a difficulty in that the law will tell them specifically what their duties are. And the law will tell them specifically what they need to do to administer an election. And this could be at any administrative body, obviously. And it gives them the mandate to do what we've asked them to do. The law can also establish independence and allow election commissions and other administrative bodies to fulfill their mandate. And the last thing, and this one I think is a little bit harder to explain, but maybe the most important. There are many issues that people do not want to have to deal with. Anti-corruption issues, registering candidates, dealing with voter registration, collecting taxes. These are not things that people normally really intend to do, but the law can establish the commitment and the will to do so. And if people do not fulfill what is required of them in the law, they can obviously be relieved of their duties, prosecuted, or whatever the remedy may be. So the hierarchy of law clearly establishes this framework, and it's very, very important to the work that we do. And I think in elections, it's particularly important because you're at a moment when the power of the executive branch is usually at question and could be transferred. And so at the time, for example, in Costa Rica, the election commission actually becomes the executive branch during that process and actually has authority over the military. so that during this time when the transfer of power is happening, it's very clear who's in charge. But everybody knows this before because it's established in the law. Imagine if the Election Commission tried to take over the military if it wasn't established in the law. I don't think anyone would accept that outcome. Now, I talked about the Constitution already, so I don't need to go over that in great deal, but what I did want to talk about quickly was international law and how it informs the hierarchy. I think all law obviously has to adhere to the Constitution, and many countries through international public law accept the concepts that are in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and other instruments, and they're enshrined in their constitution or in other legislation. And some, obviously, international law documents, there's soft law and there's hard law. By that we mean with soft law, that they're very much something that we would like a country to do, they've agreed to do it, but there's no real enforcement mechanism to enforce an international law treaty. However, there are some, like the European Court of Human Rights, where there is an actual arbitration side of the law, and it is enforced. So international public law can be very soft and not enforced, not enforceable, or it can be very hard, and it can be enforced. And there's many ways in which treaties fit within that spectrum. And so I think the most important thing is they have moral weight and acceptance from the international community. And I think we're all struggling now with what that means. How does international public law inform our own domestic law? And it's always a position of conflict. I want to talk, I've already talked about statutes and legislation, so if you have any questions later, I'm open to any questions you may have. But one thing I want to discuss, and I think what's interesting, is common law or case law. I think it's very few countries, and I realize that, that actually use common law and not, I think in Ukraine it's mostly civil law, and that's the majority of countries. However, in a practicing attorney in a common law jurisdiction, you obviously first look at court decisions to see how courts have interpreted the law. And there can be, of course, in a common law country, courts in different regions of the country can interpret the law differently, but it works up the system until it gets to the Supreme Court or the Constitutional Court. They make the final decision of how the law is interpreted, and then that is the law that you have to apply. And I hear in the meetings that I've had in Ukraine that there are times that people are looking at the way courts are interpreting regulation and using that maybe when they're filing electoral complaints and whatnot. I think you can learn from courts and judges and how they're interpreting the law and can help you in practice if you're filing complaints and trying to argue a case. So I think although it's not common law is not really adhered to in the Ukraine, I do believe there are some aspects of this in elections in particular that it could inform the way you interpret the law. I've talked about regulations and procedures, so I won't go into that in great detail further, but another interesting thing is codes of conduct. Codes of conduct are something that's passed almost in every country I've ever worked. Sometimes a code of conduct is written specifically for political parties, or it might be written for the media, or it might be written for some other body, or there are some codes of conduct that fit all of those together into one definition of the ethics or the way that people would like individuals to act within the process. Now this too is similar to international law. In some places these are soft, in some places they're hard, in some places they're just an agreement or guidelines that we would hope people would follow. But in some countries, the regulator, an election commission for example, will adopt the codes of conduct and will actually enforce them. If a political party or a candidate doesn't meet the requirements of the code of conduct, they may pull back their registration. If an election commission isn't being independent and impartial and working without fear or favor, they too could be removed from their position in a hard code of conduct sort of environment. Again, the thing that's tricky about this, however, is that whatever code of conduct that is written and signed and put into practice must adhere to the hierarchy of law. If something within that code of conduct runs counter to the Constitution, then it should be vacated, and the courts should be the ones that interpret that. I think that I have seen the codes of conduct in many countries work very, very well, and they can fill a lot of gaps in the regulations when everybody agrees to use it. The last thing that I wanted to talk about are guidelines, instructions, and policies, sometimes executive orders. These can be seen as part of the hierarchy of law as well. A lot of times they really are giving a policy interpretation. The executive branch is telling its different entities how to interpret a policy. It could be in very specific instructions of how to implement something. There could even be legislative policy. The legislation itself has decided on an overall policy in the way it's going to try to pass legislation. Or there could be an administrative policy that really is, for example, instructions to an administrative body how specifically to deal with a specific issue. Now, the Constitution should define the power of the executive branch. These policies have to fit within the powers of the executive branch as defined in the Constitution. And if they do not, they obviously need to be vacated or not used. And I believe that the courts should be the ones that interpret if these instructions and policies meet the Constitution. And as I said earlier, I think within this framework, you really do need to fit the idea of how easily do you want to change things? How quickly do you want to adopt things? Because I think as you get lower down in this chart, you'll see that it's probably easier and quicker to change something. But you don't want to make the Constitution something that's very easy to change. And I do believe that in Ukraine, when I've looked at the electoral law, I think you're very close to some of the procedure level work actually residing within the legislation. So it's actually in the statute. So that makes it very hard to change a procedure if it's in the statute. So I think it's something, if you're drafting legislation, that you really need to know how much power you're going to delegate to the administrative body, how that, whatever delegation of authority they have, that the courts can review it to make sure it's constitutional. So what does this mean in practice? I hope this isn't too obvious, and it might be very difficult to read. It's very small. I don't know if you have copies. I just wanted to talk through four quick examples of how this works in practice. So for the issue of voter registration, the Constitution would enshrine the right to vote, but it wouldn't have any specifics about voter registration, probably. The law may specify who qualifies to register to vote, but it's not going to have procedure or process in it. The regulation might include a list of documents that are acceptable to prove that you're eligible to vote, but then the procedure on where you would register, the size of the photograph you have to provide, the duties of the registration staff, the forms you would use, that would all be down at the procedural level. So that's how this interacts with one another. Again, if the procedure for some reason requires something that runs counter to the right to vote, if the procedure makes it very difficult, you know, in the United States, it's a real problem that trying to make people get voter ID that they cannot obtain because of whatever reason, then they're not able to register to vote, then it runs counter to the Constitution. And we've had numerous cases recently where states are putting procedures in place that make it almost impossible to register to vote, and the courts are finding those to be unconstitutional. Candidate nomination. I think in the time that I've researched election complaints in Ukraine, candidate registrations within the administrative court is a very big issue. It seems like this is where most of the litigation happens. Now, a constitution would enshrine the right to stand for election, which is consistent with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The law would specify who qualifies to stand for elections. Sometimes that's in the Constitution too. The regulation may specify the fees required, the signatures, the number of signatures you may need and whatnot. And then the procedures would describe the candidate papers, the forms you would use, who you would register when, etc. On polling, again, the Constitution would provide elections by secret ballot, also in keeping with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The law or the legislation would specify who's responsible for conducting polling. The regulation would set the hours, etc. And the procedure would actually how you set up the polling station, the responsibilities of the precinct level employees and the like. And then complaints adjudication. I think here it's really interesting that there's a little bit of confused jurisdiction. Candidates can file with the Election Commission or they can file with the Administrative Court. If the Administrative Court obviously takes up the case, then the Election Commission has to drop it. But it still could be an issue of forum shopping. It could confuse jurisdiction a little bit. I've not heard it be a huge problem, but there's a potential there. But the right to file an appeal of an election result should be in the Constitution. The law should really be specific about who has jurisdiction. The regulations would set out the rules for the complaint and the areas in which you could file a complaint, maybe. But then the procedure the court follows would be something the court could define in and of themselves, and it shouldn't require legislation to try to change that. Now, an issue, and this one is not covered in our paper, but I was asked to talk about it a little bit. What do you do when a regulation in one area, in one oblast, contradicts with another? What if a regulation, if you live in one area and you go to another and file a complaint, but they're different regulations, what do you do then? And I think there are three variables that you can look at. You can look at who has jurisdiction over the person. Where does a person reside? What's their domicile? Do you apply the rules of the location in which the person lives and domicile? That's one option, and you can justify that through your reasoning as to why, as long as you're consistent. Or is it more important that the court has jurisdiction over this specific issue? Is it some sort of a registration issue that's in a specific district, but the person resides in another area? You probably should apply the rules that are in the region in which the complaint is filed. And then the other thing you can look at is what's the remedy? What are you trying to resolve, and what are your options for resolving it? I think you can balance these three things when you're looking at a regulation or a procedure that is in conflict with one another. Of course, if a law, if the legislation itself or a statute has conflicts in it, that's a different problem. And then obviously either the court needs to define that or a new law has to be passed to make sure that the conflict is resolved. So that really is the subject of I'm about through on my time. I really do hope that you have questions. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions that you have. Like I said, I think that the interest in this is pretty high around the world. We have a lot of people ask about this paper. And I think in the end of the day, it's the Constitution and making sure that the regulations and everything below it fit within that framework, that international law obligations are resigned in all of the law that's passed, and that you have to give the administrative bodies that have authority to write regulations and procedures the ability to do so. I hope those are the main takeaways from the presentation, and with that, I'll open it up to questions.
Дякуємо шановному доктору Чаду Вікері. Дуже цікава доповідь. Хотів би також відзначити, що багато було сказано про ЦВК, про її повноваження. Мене сьогодні запрошували і мав бути присутній наш працівник інституту, головний науковий співробітник, колишній голова Центральної виборчої комісії. Член-кореспондент НАН України Володимир Миколаївич Шаповал. На жаль, керівництво його викликало для проведення інших консультацій, тому він на сьогодні його немає, він відсутній, але на подальші заходи, які будуть проведені в межах співробітництва інституту і фундації, він, звичайно, буде підключатись. Він, по суті, буде організовувати і спрямовувати цей процес. Звичайно, те, що було озвучено, особливо по ієрархії, воно важко накладається на нашу правову систему, тобто багато є таких, скажімо так, неточностей. Тобто це не точний трафарет, коли наклав і все співпало. Тому я думаю, що у наших колег є питання, там де ми можемо знайти, скажімо так, точки дотику, точки застосування того, що було озвучено з урахуванням українських реалій. Тому запрошуємо до дискусії. До запитання, бо дискусії у нас, я думаю, спільно прийдемо. Прошу, колеги. Прошу.
Краще українською чи англійською? Я можу. I better ask in English regarding policies. Andrei Kruglashov, MP, is Dean of Political Science and Consultant for India, Ukraine. You here put policies on the lowest branch of hierarchy. At the same time, explain their broad nature. Can policies serve an umbrella norm or umbrella function to link different legislation from different areas? And if yes, how it usually works? Because we are here in Ukraine starting our attempts to do policy consultations, to develop, especially on election legislation and access to politics per se, which combines media, access to media, administration of election process, norms that regulate threshold, length of campaigning, political finance, and we perceive it to be a broad policy, but if it's so low in hierarchy, maybe we should try something else. Maybe how it can be helpful for us to make a change in framing. Thank you.
I don't think that you want to see, because it's lower in the pyramid, that it's less important. I think you just have to understand that it has to fit within the one above it, and so on. So I think if a procedure can combine different areas of law into a practice that is reasonable, then they ought to, so long as the procedure and the law fit within the constitutional. You would never want a procedure to run counter to a constitutional right, if that makes sense. But I think, I don't think they're less important. Matter of fact, the procedures in the end of the day are probably the most important, because that's the way the person interacts with the law. But it just has to answer to the Constitution and the legal framework, if that makes sense.
Дякую, пан доктор. Доктор Чад Вікері. Шановні, хотів би задати питання, можливо, воно трошки не з вашої тематики буде, сьогоднішньої, але впевнений, що ви як фахівець знайдете відповідь. Одна з найстаріших виборчих систем – це виборча система Сполучених Штатів. Ну, для нас частково вона, скажімо так, складна для розуміння і сприйняття. Ми чули, я думаю, що це відповідає дійсності, що в деяких виборах, наприклад, президентських, перемагає особа, за якою голосувало меншість від громадян, які мають право голосу. Для України, якщо це відбудеться, ну, це може призвести до різних наслідків, як правових, так і політичних. Як ви вважаєте, от така система, вона відповідає Конституції, зокрема Конституції Штатів, яка так само є одна з сталих демократичних, чи відповідає це принципу верховенства права? Дякую.
Well, this is my personal opinion. And I do believe you're referring to the Electoral College in the United States. I think that the Electoral College should be changed, and the Constitution, when it was drafted, was a compromise at the time to keep the federal states together, but time has passed and that should change. I think the Electoral College is absolutely a weakness, and I would also suggest that at IFES, and this isn't part of this discussion, we talk about within an election, there can be vulnerabilities to something that can make sure the election does not reflect the will of the voters. There can be mistakes that are made, sometimes called malpractice. An election administrator could literally make a mistake in the count or something. There can be fraud. There can be, somebody can intentionally try to change the outcome by stuffing a ballot box or whatever the case may be, or restricting registration of candidates. Or there's another area that we call systemic manipulation. By that we mean the laws are written in a way that benefit one party over the other. In the United States, I would argue there are two types of systemic manipulation that need to be addressed. The first is the Electoral College. Most people in my country might not agree with me. But the other one, and I think the one that's even more egregious still, is the gerrymandering of election districts. In the United States, if you're elected to Congress, once you're elected, you have about a 96 or 98% re-election rate that you will be re-elected for the rest of your life because of gerrymandering. So in the United States, there are court cases. There's been a lot, I won't bore you with the litigation on gerrymandering, but it's been going on for a very long time. And there's a court case out of Wisconsin, a state in the North Midwest, that may actually get rid of gerrymandering for congressional districts. It will go to the Supreme Court in the next few months. Because I actually think that gerrymandering is worse than the Electoral College. There are ways to fix the Electoral College without changing the Constitution. The Electoral College actually is in the Constitution. The way that it's constructed is in the Constitution. So you could change it by changing the way the electors vote that makes sure that the person who wins, the popular vote wins. But right now, that is not an issue. So to answer your question, yes, the election is compliance with the Constitution, but I don't think it meets international norms in some ways. But at the same time, the citizens at large accept the Electoral College as the way in which they're choosing a president. There's not people in the streets trying to change the Electoral College. There aren't legislators trying to change it. I would hope that there would be.
Тобто це ми так само, до речі, маємо проблеми з певними виборчими округами, коли вони формуються. Але те, що ви озвучили, ще раз свідчить, що ідеальних систем немає. Є маневри і поле для роздумів, для дискусій, для пошуку. Дякую. Шановні колеги, які є ще питання? Питання, можливо, дискусії, обговорення? Так, прошу.
Дякую шановному доповідачу за цікаву доповідь. У мене не буде запитань. Я хотіла б декілька реплік, тому що я думаю, що такого роду лекції будуть не тільки в Інституті законодавства і не одна. І мої репліки зводяться до наступного. Мені здається, що дуже невдалий переклад теми лекції, тому що говорити про ієрархію законів не можна. Треба говорити про ієрархію нормативних актів. І коли ми використовуємо термінологію ієрархії нормативних актів, то дійсно на першому місці стоїть Конституція, потім міжнародні договори, ратифіковані парламентом України, потім закони України. І коли ми говоримо про закони України, то вони розповсюджуються на всю територію України і є абсолютно рівними між собою. Ніякої ієрархії законів бути не може. Після законів йдуть підзаконні нормативні акти, до яких слід віднести і укази президента, і постанови Кабінету міністрів, і так далі, і тому інше. Тому, ну, мені здається, що це все ж таки просто був не дуже вдалий переклад. Ієрархія законів, треба використовувати ієрархію нормативних актів. І наступне. Оскільки я вже сказала, що закони України, вони діють на всій території України, то в нас неможливо ситуації, коли в одній області приймається один закон, а в іншій області інший закон. В області можуть прийматися локальні нормативні акти, які мають відповідати закону. І тому такої ситуації, про яку говорив шановний доповідач, неможливо. І третій варіант. На жаль, на превеликий жаль, в Україні не діє прецедентне право. Є окремі тільки елементи прецедентного права, коли ми говоримо про діяльність найвищого судового органу Верховного суду України. На сьогодні висновки Верховного суду України є обов'язковими для використання судами інших інстанцій. Але це зовсім не означає, що суди нижчих інстанцій не можуть прийняти рішення, не враховуючи висновки Верховного суду. Вони можуть не слідувати висновкам, але за умови належного обґрунтування. Дякую дуже.
Дякую.
Буде у вас репліка? Буде якась?
No, I don't think so. I think I tried to say that I know that this isn't a common law jurisdiction, so I understand that. My point was there can be times in looking at other decisions can inform the way you might argue a case if you were a lawyer, is all. We were looking at this study internationally, not just Ukraine, and we couldn't just not mention common law countries. And I would be surprised if none of the local laws contradict other local laws. But if Ukraine is a country that has absolutely no contradictions in its legal framework, congratulations, you might be the first country I've ever heard of that has zero contradictions in their legal frameworks.
Тут більше все-таки мова йде, коли є конфлікти, є невідповідність, це більше правозастосовуючої практики, скажімо так, органів, які створені Центральною виборчою комісією, територіальною виборчою комісією, окружній виборчою комісією і так далі. Так, прошу, колеги, чи будуть ще запитання? У вас ще одне буде? Да, можна.
By the way, where would you see in the hierarchy of laws here the acts which are produced by our local city councils or their decisions? How would you put them, just so we would know? It is more about decisions regarding land use, for example, or renaming some objects or demolishing certain local objects, communal property, yeah, that's right. Appointing someone, is it just merely instruction or regulation, or it's not law at all? Maybe.
No, I think it is a decision, and it's affecting people's lives. So I don't know exactly, but from what the way you're describing it, I think if the Constitution gives a local government the power to do those things, then the way that it's interpreting that are regulations and procedures.
Okay.
Now, again, as I said earlier, anything they do has to fit within the Constitution. So if they're taking property that they should not, and according to the Constitution, those regulations or procedures should be, the court should vacate those decisions.
Thank you.
Дякуємо. Чи будуть ще репліки? Да, прошу.
Дякую. Хотів би також подякувати спікеру дуже цікава така просвітницька лекція, безумовно, для нас. І я так розумію, що, скоріш за все, ваша структура, виявляючи інтерес до нашого правового поля, несе, крім повідомлення і певну функцію спостереження за нашим виборчим процесом. Я рахую, що те, про що ви говорили, стосується передусім процедурної сторони самого виборчого процесу, який має місце. А перед тим, як почались вибори, як ви оцінюєте рівень нашого вітчизняного законодавства з точки зору, скажімо, досконалості західноєвропейського, американського? От мене здивувала сьогодні буквально вранці інформація, йдуть вибори в Нідерландах буквально сьогодні, і демонструє наша журналістка, як на задньому фоні її виступу, кілька представників різних партій агітують в процесі нашого процесі виборів. Якби це було в нас, це, певне, вже був би фурор, і вибори б визнані однозначно недійсними, і політичні сили визнали б, що тут повна невідповідність демократичним європейським стандартам. Але тим паче, на ваш погляд, отакі деталі і наша реальність, як вони співставляються вашими очима? Буду дякувати.
Unfortunately, I've been in Ukraine for 3 days. I don't think I should be an expert on Ukrainian law. So I won't make a judgment of that. And also, I think something that's important too, IFES as an institution normally works with election commissions, maybe even help to draft procedures or to use best practices and that sort of thing. We do not observe elections because if we're assisting the election commission, we think it would be a conflict of interest for us to also serve as observers. So other groups do election observation. We may do an observation if we're not assisting an election commission, but it's almost always in a very technical way. So unfortunately, I can't answer your question. I'm not an expert in Ukrainian law, and I don't do election observation. But I will say that the law in regards to campaigning can fluctuate a great deal. And issues such as vote buying. In many countries, people think if an MP builds a school right before an election, that that's vote buying. In some countries, that's just constituency outreach. The way you can define these things really needs to be determined by the citizens in the country. And as long as the rules are clear in beforehand, they meet general international principles and standards, there can be a lot of variance. So I wouldn't judge what's happening in the Netherlands today in regards to their campaigning. I think they've always ranked very high on the integrity of their elections, but I'm not an expert in their elections either.
Доброго дня, Юрій Середа, Інститут Республіка. Буквально вчора був прийнятий законопроект 5520, що стосувався виборів до об'єднаних територіальних громад, які знаходяться на території різних районів, суміжних районів, або вибори, що стосуються об'єднаної територіальної громади з навколо міста обласного значення. І тут виникає така ситуація, коли наша Центральна виборча комісія до теперішнього часу відмовлялася призначати перші вибори до рад таких об'єднаних територіальних громад, мотивуючи це тим, що є певні розбіжності в законодавстві, але все ж таки посилаючись на Конституцію України. І тут виникає питання, як в інших країнах центральні виборчі комісії відносяться до наявності розбіжності в законодавстві, і чи тлумачать вони законодавство, чи все-таки це покладено на до повноважень якихось певних судових органах в цих країнах. Судових органів. Дякую.
So I guess there is a contradiction in the law. You found one already. I do believe that the courts would interpret that in most countries. I don't know the specifics of the case you're describing, so I shouldn't comment on it. But I do believe if there's a contradiction in the law, the court interprets the law and would determine which one should apply. But the legislation can always be changed. If it's a legislation area below the Constitution, then the Parliament or the legislature could change the law, and they should fix the inconsistency. But I don't know the case that you're citing specifically, so I really shouldn't comment on it.
Тоді, колеги, якщо немає питань, ми будемо дякувати
пану доктору Чаду Вікарі. Дякуємо вам. Сподіваємося, що подальші зустрічі так само буде, будуть співробітники фундації виборчих систем. До речі, якого але він? 25-го? 25-го в Інституті законодавства відбудеться захід.
Круглий стіл. Да. Де він? 25-го в Інституті законодавства відбудеться так само спільний круглий стіл, який присвячений правам, виборчим правам внутрішньо переміщених осіб і їх участю в виборах. В кого є бажання, ми так само запрошуємо. Це другий захід, надалі буде ще ряд заходів, присвячений подібній, або, тобто виборчій проблематиці різним її аспектам. Дякую всім учасникам. Якщо будуть питання, будь ласка, підходьте. Раді будемо співробітничати. Дякую ще раз доктору Чаду Вікторовичу.